So, hello everyone. First of all, sorry for my bad English, but I'm still studying, so also sorry for my pronunciation if it's not perfect. And my name is Claudio, and I've been using Panda3D since 2008, and I developed some software also for the core. So, let's look what we're going to talk today. The first part of this talk is about the general concepts of 3D real-time graphics. The second part is about the inner structure of Panda3D. Then I'll show you some practical examples, code of course. And then I wrote a mini game just to show you the potential of this framework just for EuroPython. So, for the general concepts, I may ask how many of you have ever worked with real-time graphics? Okay, so I'll explain for those who have never worked with that. We're talking about things like this. These are some screenshots about many games written with the Panda3D. This is a rescue game. This is a game that has been developed by the Carnegie Mellon University in just 2 weeks. And it has also some blurs, filters, and shaders. And so it's very, very fast to develop applications. Also this one. And this is a screenshot from Pirates of the Caribbean Online. It's a game from Disney Interactive Center. And so Panda3D is used also by large companies like Disney. And so, how does it work? It works more or less like the cinema. In cinema we have a series of frames that are shown one after the other so quickly. And it gives us the illusion of a continuous movement. These frames should be seen at least 16 times per second, but this is not a fixed rule. In fact, they should be about 22 per second. The difference from cinema is that the video game, a real-time graphic application, is interactive. So in cinema, everything is just decided, it's fixed. But in a video game, the next frame is generated depending on the user input. So that could be action from characters, or maybe some simulation algorithm like physics engine or other stuff. Okay. This is the structure of a real-time application. At first, we have the rendering phase of a frame in which the picture is generated from the renderer. Then the frame which is generated is displayed on our screen. And then the software takes care of our input. It performs some simulations. And depending on it, it renders the frame. So this is the circle. And it must be done at least 16 times per second. But the optimal frame rate is about at least 30 at best 60 per second. Okay. How the render generates the frame? There is the rendering phase in which the renderer rasterize the picture. It creates the picture from the 3D scene and from the camera. It's more or less like cinema. Also in cinema we have a camera and we have a scene in which are placed objects and lights. For objects, here I mean not only physical objects that we can see, for example like a chair, like a table, like a mouse, that we can see, but also invisible objects, like triggers. For example, if I need to make my character jump when enters a specific area of the scene, I need to put an object there, and when the character walks in the object, he jumping. And so it's generated from a camera in a 3D scene. And this is the scheme of the software, how it's written. Then first we create the scene. First we create the scene and we put the camera in the scene. And then we start the main cycle of the application, which means render frame, display it, taking care of user input and perform some simulation, then modifying the scene, and like repositioning camera or other objects, and then start the game from rendering a frame. And also, of course, it has been done 16 times per second. Now, scene objects. For scene objects, I'm referring to meshes, so not all kind of objects, like lights, like actors, animated objects. I refer just to meshes that are needed specifying two features. One is geometry and the other is material. Okay, for geometry, it's just the surface of an object. It means it's just a group of vertex that are placed in a 3D space. Connected, creating edges and faces. So it's just the shape of the object. It involves no light reaction, no color, nothing. Okay. Then materials. An object has a material. And the material defines the way in which the object reacts to light. So if we have some direct light, reflection, refraction, some of these attributes. And in materials are also mapped the textures that gives the outer color. In fact, materials can also define the solid color for some parts of an object and textures are just images that are wrapped around the object. So, this is the way the camera takes the 3D scene. We have the camera there, which is in our viewpoint. Our viewpoint is a 3D point in our scene. Then there's the viewplane. The viewplane is the rasterized image, like a for example, a picture of what the camera sees. And it comes directly from the frustum view, which is a frustum that shows the area that our camera can see. It depends also on the lens of the camera. For example, for lens, photographic or perspective, in cinema it's not possible, of course, to have an orthographic lens. But in real-time graphic, yes. And we can set many attributes to the lens that we apply to the camera. For example, we can see, we can have a field of view. The field of view is how is that large, our frustum. And we can have a larger one or a smaller one. And we can also change this lens in real time. So achieving some special effects, like in cinema. For example, zooming to an object and getting closer to the object, but zooming out. And so that we create this this field of view modifier in some ways. Also in the video game Left 4 Dead, if someone knows, has been used this technique, but also with saturation in order to give us fear. But that's our advanced technique. Okay. Then the tools that we have are rendered, modeling software, and then there's the production chain. So the renderer is just a software that gives us algorithm and data structures that simplify our work. This is intended like a scene graph, for example, and the programmer just take care of positioning camera and objects in the 3D scene, and the renderer just rasterize the image. The renderer also is the interface between the programmer and the low-level application interface, which are OpenGL, for example, and like this. So we do not need to know this happy. And so, of course, the renderer could render as many frames as possible, as quickly as possible, because of our performance. Then, within the modeling software, this is the open source Blender that I use also for my game. It's well supported. But for Panda3D, is supported many others modeling software like Maya, 3D Studio Max, or Cinema 4D. There are many supporters. And in fact, this is the production chain of our game. First, we need to have an idea. Then, when we know what we need, we want to do, we can start by modeling the objects, and also defining in Blender, for example, we define the material, we can wrap textures, so it's a complete software. And then we convert from blend to egg. Egg is the file type of Panda. And we need models to the rendering engine. The rendering engine gives us the image, the frames that can be used for other software. of various kind, like videogames, like like images processing, so real-time application, but also renderers can be referred for non-real-time applications. For example, Blender is just it was well known for being an editor of static scenes, static, not real time, that use ray tracing techniques that are too heavy for using in real time applications. Okay. Now let's talk about Panda3D. Panda3D is a game engine, so it is able to handle more or less everything you need to have for creating a video game, from rendering, input, audio, physics, interface, user interface, also networking. It has some advanced features like shaders, supports, post-processing filters, and also strange things that are not common, like the support for the NVIDIA physics engine, and a small artificial intelligence engine, which is not so good, but I tried to understand that. So it could be comfortable for some projects. It's not highly personally stable. Custom table. Okay, and another feature which is so cool is the automatic deployment system. It's a system that allow us to distribute our software in a very easy way, because we just take the directory of the game. We create an all-in-one package called a P3D package that contains everything, from models to textures to our Python source code, of course. It generates an installer for every architecture, because Panda3D supports Linux, supports macOS, Linux, supports Windows. So, yeah, I'm an open source enthusiastic. I'm using Windows just because I don't have drivers for my video card. Yeah. Okay. And there's also a web plugin in which we can load E3D packages and so distribute our games through the web. Okay. Then, how is handled the 3D scene? Panda3D. It's organized by a graph composed by various nodes, like there, start, type 1, type 2, and then nodes. And every node has a parent and potentially infinite nodes, child nodes. So the parent can have as many moons as it wants. Okay. But there are some nodes that are at the top that are called the root nodes and are called render 2D, aspect 2D, and hidden. These are at the very top of the C graph, always. And these root nodes, for example, if we represent an object under render to render. That object will be shown in the 3D scene, applying a perspective lens or the lens that is applied to the camera. If we represent it to the render 2D, we will see that object in the two-dimensional screen, but quite stretched, because the ratio aspect between width and height is not is one, is simply one. So if we have a white screen, the height is one, the width is one, and so our image will be stretched because it's okay. The aspect 2D works like an HD, but it gives us the freedom of the radio. It is not one on one, but is one on the screen. And so we, through aspect 2D, we will have pixel perfect images. It's also used by the user interface, because it's, of course, it's a need to be not to be stretched. And the last node is the hidden node that does not render nothing. So if we want to hide some objects, we can use the specific method of the object. So we just call hide, and then we hide, or maybe we can rebind it to render in order to move it out from the render scene graph or other scene graph. Okay. This is, for example, an example of a possible graph. So render, for render 2D, we are at the top. Then we have childs, one over another. Okay. And in the scene, we have the panda nodes, which is the very base class of every node in the graph, panda node. So there could be light nodes, model nodes, gem node, also lens node, the lens applied to the camera is a node, and everything inherits from the original panda node class, so represents a node in a scene graph. Then, but these nodes are all together in the same scene, and we would think to have a transformation or some transformation that affect any node. For example, if I want to translate a light or translate a chair, it's pretty much the same thing, because it's just a transformation in the scene graph. So there is an interface, some kind of unified interface for every panda node that is called the node path. The node path is more or less could be seen like a pointer, but technically it's not. It's an object, in fact, that is used to handle the real panda node. When we do some transformation that are panda node independent, we always use the node path. It's easily used while developing. If we need the real node that is behind, we can use the method node to get the node. And other features are that child nodes act like parent. For example, if I have a solar system, which means the sun at the top, and then all the planets represented to the sun, and if I move the sun will move with all the planets represented to it. This means that the transformation to a parent node affects all the children. And then another interesting feature is that the node path could be also empty, just pointing to nothing. And it's useful because we can group other nodes. We can create a node path that contains other node paths, and this is useful when we need to have a group of objects inside the scene. Okay, these are the transformation that we can perform on the 3D scene, so scaling objects, getting bigger or smaller, positioning on the three axes, and also rotation, which means taking. Yeah, it's self-explanatory. Okay, then these are. Okay. The main feature of Panda, the Panda is built upon the task system. A task is a function or method which is called every frame during the generation of every frame. We have this function which calls in which we pass a parameter called task that provides information about the task. And the main problem is that the application is stuck, is blocked until the task function returns. And so it could be a performance problem if we are working in real time like in video games. Okay, then there's the event management system. In Panda, we manage events through a system that allows us to accepting events and calling function and methods depending on who accepts the events. I mean, I can accept events in the base class, which is global, in the global scope. That means that events are accepted in all the program, but. A particular feature is that also the objects can accept events. So for example, this paper can accept an event, and it is somewhat strange, but it's very useful because we can group certain events to certain objects. For example, if I have got a character, can I make the character accepting some events, and when the character dies, so it's removed from the 3D scene, events. All the events that are accepted by that character will not be accepted anymore. So it's very useful, this feature. Okay. Then are the light nodes. Okay, there are many kind of light in Panda, but every light is a node in the graph, of course, and it has the six coordinates for the three axes. It has a color formed by red, green, blue, and also alpha, and can go from white to black. Okay, and has an attenuation. Parameter that we can set the linear, the exponential, and the quadratic. Then I can show to you. Just 1 second. Also, this is a software that I wrote. This is a scene editor. Okay. We have a point light, just like this. And we can move around the light, and also this is the I'm modifying the detonation attribute. And so this is more likely, this is less. There are many kinds of lights. There are point lights that has a position but no rotation, like a light bulb. So it gets all the scene to illuminate it lightly. Okay. But then are the directional light, which has no position but just rotation. So it's an infinite rays of light that goes into one direction. Then there's an ambient light, which has no position, no rotation, so it's just in order not to have a completely dark world. And then there is a spotlight, which has a position, rotation, and a lens. The position is just like a torch, more or less, because it gets a circle illuminated. So it has to use a lens for perspective calculations. Okay, then there are Riva. I'm not giving care in this talk because they have less time than the original talk, which is more. Okay, and so let's see some advanced features like post-processing filters. How works a filter? How does a filter work? Okay, a filter works more or less like in Photoshop or in GIMP. So we render an image in an off-screen buffer. A buffer is a place where the rendered pictures are placed, more or less. An off-screen buffer is not shown on our display. So we render the pictures in this off-screen buffer that we don't see. Then we apply the filter. And then we display it on a full-screen quad. Okay, a quad is just a group of vertex that goes from one corner to the other, covering all the screen. And so we display the final picture on this square on our display. And the amazing thing about Panda is that many filters are just integrated into the code. For example, green filter cut linking the so-called God rays, the volumetric lightning, the invert, and also the ambient occlusion. And I'll show you one of these. This is one of the filters, automatic filters provided by Panda. It's the cartooning thing. You can also modify in real time how the filter works on the image. In this case, to increase the line darkness and thickness. And this is made by the Panda engine, and so we don't need to build some shaders or something else. And like this, there are many others, for example, Zoom. And then there are the shaders. Panda really can handle shaders written in the GLSL or in NVIDIA CG language. NVIDIA CG is just a is a language that compiles GLSL, and so more or less it is an abstraction upon GLSL and HLSL. So if we write shaders in CG, we can run them not thinking if our renderer is based upon OpenGL or DirectX. So shaders runs directly on our GPU. So our programs that runs in our video card, and they can be of different types. The vertex shader that is executed for every vertex, because modifying every vertex for every frame, of course. And there's the geometry shader, which modifies the mesh geometry, so the shape of the object. There is then there is the pixel shader, which modifies the pixel color. And then there is the computer, the compute shader, which is used for generic computation. So, for example, deploying if some compute. Okay. The cool thing is the shader generator in Panda. It's a small module that writes the shaders for us. So if we need, for example, normal mapping, and we are too lazy to write our specific shader in order to do normal mapping, we just tell Panda we want to do normal mapping on a specific object with that, of course, with that heat map for the object, and Panda just writes the specific shader for that particular object, so we don't need to write a single line of GG or CG or GLSL. This is that Panda also has tool sharing, which is often used with cartoon inking. Also has an HDR rendering, high dynamic range rendering, which is used often with the room filter. And some example for us, let's show you. This is a new filter with a shadow. Okay, this is the glowness of the picture. You can turn it on, turn it off. This is with no shader and filter. With shader, and it works also for animating objects. I was a bit bored. The graduation, because Wednesday I'm having my graduation exams. and I'm studying so hard today, you can see. And I am not interested in history of art, and I had a teacher that I didn't like so much. Then, just a bit of Panda3D, Blender, and GIMP. And I wrote this little game in which the player is a desk that moves around. The weapon is a pencil. It's a pencil which is very hard. So. And the enemies are spiders and pyramids, in which originally there was the face of my teacher, but for privacy reasons, of course, I won't show you today. And the objective is to make the best, the highest score without being defeated or maybe lose the year. Okay, and I show you just the final work.
Does it work like a state machine, like DirectX, OpenGL? I'm saying, does it work with load, update, draw? How is it coded?
Like,
yeah. Have you done OpenGL by any chance?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, you have a section where before drawing the frame, yeah, you update the logic of the game. So I don't know. Then you check inputs, and then depending on the whatever happens, you modify the game logic, and then you draw it. Yeah. You draw the every component in the game. Does that work like that, or
yeah.
Okay?
It works like that.
And second question.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard of Unity?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you think of that?
Unity.
I should have. Said this.
No.
Okay.
I tried many things.
Okay.
But
yeah.
This speaks to me because it's very, very, very simple.
Okay. But isn't Unity very, very simple?
Yeah, Unity is very
and
simple.
And you can also deploy to everything.
But I prefer the Panda because it's free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, even Unity is free. You can actually.
You can deploy, for example,
on mobiles, no, you have to pay for that. Yeah,
I don't think Unity is open source yet.
No, it's not open source.
No,
it's
open source.
It is commercial, but you can deploy to
EC3. And also, Unity, for example, I can develop with Unity on Linux.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I usually use Linux. This is just because I wanted to avoid problems with this.
Yeah, sure.
Because I got some unstable drivers and so.
No, but I'm very curious. I should look it up.
That's the reason. And then Panda has got a very active community. It's so little, but it helps you a lot. They never get angry if you keep questioning every time.
How do you add functionality to, so how do you add behaviors? Do you, would you subclass known paths?
Subclass known paths?
Or do you write objects that manage
bunches of known paths? For example, in my game, I subclass it from from a class that is called a direct object. Direct object is not panda node, which is the node, which is the parent class of every node, but is more general. Direct object is an object integrated into Panda. So, for example, you saw all the spiders. This is, of course, it's not the word written, but for example, now this is my desk. I just made my desk image from type object, and that gives me some very comfortable functionalities. For example, accepting events. Inheriting from typed object, make my object accepting events, and so it's like that. I don't know if I
Does it make any sense to use this to make a 2D game? Considering that the library for 2D games.
I think it doesn't make much sense because Panda is developed in a very, very 3D way, and so also for managing the two-dimensional screen is often a problem. Or also because for example, there could be collision problems. You don't have classes that makes your life easier if you want collision in the world. Sometimes maybe you should just repair all the objects to the two-dimensional screen render 2D. And then make your display work as a 3D like world, which is not comfortable. I should use game by game, which is oriented to the 2D. I might be not just 3D. Okay. Any other?
I have three questions. The first one is, can objects have an internal structure, or do you only have a surface structure? Or can you define, internal structure so that when it explodes, you have...
Yeah, we have a class that allows us to manage all the vertex one by one. For example, when generating net mesh for pathfinding problems, we analyze the mesh, the geometry, and we take one vertex after the other, and then build all the mesh. And so is that
so that means you can define objects with a pile objects like.
You can generate procedural models. For example, you can just define a cube by code. This
is what and when you were showing the pyramid, you shoot the pyramid. Can you define a pyramid that gets, you shoot the envelope that's away?
I think you can do it. But I don't know if there are automatic systems. For example, I was building a real-time strategy game in which were stick people, that, okay, and that physics engine, of course. Because you define the arm, arms, the head, the various pieces of the model, and then you let them explode. So you can just divide.
You can define
your model.
Right. Just have one more. For the ray tracing, do you use PDRT, or do you use what kind of...
For ray tracing in real time?
Yeah.
Ray tracing is not possible to do in real time.
Okay.
Unless some experimentation by NVIDIA recently. Pure ray tracing?
You
can do it pure ray tracing.
Okay.
You have, for example, some approximations, of course.
Okay.
Tracing is done, for example, by blender rendering just image.
Okay.
Other questions?
Yeah, I'm not much into this, but I understand that you have ports of SDL or GL to Python. That you can use SDL libraries from Python or OpenGL libraries from Python.
If you can use the library start,
Sorry? So, kind of putting things in place, where would this go? This kind of replaces all the other libraries? The SDL library? The SDL library that is kind of manages all the inputs and the rendering. I understand it can be used from Python. And, is this kind of a replacement, or?
I don't know into the core if it is a replacement, but in Panda you usually use just the classes. Because if you go outside, they don't help you in case of trouble. It's my view. I don't know if I was pretty good, so actually.
Is there support for skeletal deletion of the characters?
Supported. It's a bit tricky because you have to use a certain version of Blender for Blender, and then you have, for example, you have to apply a modifier, a skeletal modifier, and then you have to animate it. But you can do it. And also, you can I've seen some examples of fractal physics based on the this concept of skeletal animation. Other questions? Okay, if somebody has other questions outside here, I'm busy in the channels, and then I will be at the party so we can talk. Okay, I hope you have taken some inspiration from this talk. All this.